Good evening, everybody. Thank you for coming back again and again. It's really been an exciting journey. I know some of the things are a little tough to grasp, but I think we should get used to battling some of the tough concepts. In the sense, not tough because they are tough, it's just tough because sometimes not so easy to grasp and understand and get into the depth of it. But I like the spirit with which you guys are coming back and really excites me to put in more effort. I would like to start with talking about what we talked about in the previous chapter and the whole concept of seasons. I want to repeat some of those things and clarify. So you can probably listen to this particular voice note even after the study is over, or whenever you are doing chapter number 3, you can probably listen to this part of the message also for some clarity. Now, sin brought such an impact on this world that it left a profound negative impact on all of creation. Everything in creation was directed towards God. I'm talking about before the fall. Everything was directed towards God. But sin turned the direction around. And everything turned towards death and eternal separation from God. Everything was in order, but sin turned everything into disorder. Look at the creation now. What is left? When the creation is left to itself, everything in nature will only become worse. Things will rust, things will dust, things will rot, things will degrade. All these things are normal things. In the language of physics, this is called the second law of thermodynamics, called entropy or disorder. But I'm not going into that. So all of creation was subject to go on a journey towards doom, with an overwhelming influence of the new entrants into the equation, that is weeping, mourning, killing, stealing, hatred, fighting, and everything that falls in that category. So creation was left on a hopeless downward slope. It could have been left there, but God intervened and said that weeping cannot go on forever. It has to have a limit. He said that fighting cannot go on forever. It has to have a limit. And He set time limits to everything. So when He set a time limit to weeping, it gave room for smiling. When He set a time limit to fighting, it gave room for peace. Thus, seasons were created for weeping and for smiling. Seasons were created for fighting and peace. So creating seasons was God's way of graciously allowing goodness into this world and into our lives. Also, we will go through multiple seasons at any point in our lives, like today, just today. You are in a certain season at home, but in a certain other season with regards to work, and still another season with regards to the church. At the same time, you may be in a different season in your finances, and still different season in your spiritual life, and still another season in your relationships. So many seasons will be simultaneously happening in our lives. Some may be up, some may be down, some may be good, some may be bad. But the grace of God makes sure that if you are in a downward season at work, you will get an upward season at church. Or if you are at a downward season in your finances, you are at an upward season in your relationships. Or if you are in a downward cycle in your spirituality, your spouse is in an upward cycle in her or his spirituality. God has an amazing way of balancing the seasons in our life and adding grace into our lives. God only means good. The notable aspect about tasks and season, that's what was a little confusing for some of you, is that season is defined for a task. If there is no task, that season is not there. For example, if your finances are in bad shape, you have to work to make it better. Probably the work might not help the finances much, but you still have to work. That season will pass and a good season will come, because that's the promise of God. That's why God intervened. But if you do nothing about that bad phase of finances, and sit in a corner doing nothing about your finances, you might only do more damage by doing everything possible to make that season longer than it was supposed to be. So being in a task, doing whatever you can at that time is the way to be. If you don't occupy in tasks, the opposing season may pass by us and we may miss opportunities. Hope this sheds a little clarity on the topics of seasons and the relationship between tasks and seasons. Let me quickly do the review of what we have done so far in Ecclesiastes. The first three chapters of Ecclesiastes helped us see how the critic considered three different aspects of life. First thing he considered is wisdom. Wisdom he found as leading to sorrows, and only reason to embrace it was that it is better than foolishness. And that also during our lifetime here on the earth. Though that advantage too vanished at death, because death was an equalizer, the foolish and the wisdom and the wise all died the same death. Second thing he considered was riches. Riches enabled us to get a lot of things, namely pleasure, work and projects, possessions. But then we cannot keep the riches with us, but have to pass it on to someone else who might not even value it. Then he considered tasks. When we looked at tasks, which we cannot escape from, but we have to do, as they occupy us as we pass through the seasons of our life, we saw that we are appointed to do tasks by God. But while doing this task, we should accommodate the fact that there will be injustice, and at some point of time it may look meaningless to even engage in any task, but we will still have to do them because it's a divine appointment and it is linked to the various seasons of our life. But the sum total of the considering wisdom, riches, tasks was that eventually these things by themselves do not give us anything. It does not add anything into us which will remain forever. For this life, while we are on the earth, they are needed and we will not abandon them, but we will not make them the reason to find meaning in our lives, the reason for fulfillment. For more details, you should listen to the previous studies on each of these chapters. So let me start with chapter number 4. Chapter 3 ends saying that a man should rejoice in his works. A man should rejoice in whatever labor he is involved in. But chapter 4 begins with the critic citing one of the biggest reasons why people will have difficulty rejoicing in their works or tasks or occupations. And what is that reason? That there is widespread oppression. When someone has power over another person's time or another person's money or another person's goods or his trade and business or even his freedom, his movement, and then with that kind of power and authority, he deals unkindly or unjustly in all these matters or any of them, it is called oppression. The critic says there is widespread oppression in the world under the sun. There's harassment at almost every level. The list of oppression is quite long. Servants oppressed by their masters, workers oppressed by their employers, subjects oppressed by their rulers, small farmers and tenants oppressed by their landlords, poor are oppressed by everyone, orphans and widows by whoever can. Borrowers are oppressed by lenders. Buyers are oppressed by sellers. Seekers of justice are oppressed by judges and advocates. Children are oppressed by their parents. Wives are oppressed by their husbands. And the oppression that is inside the relationship of in-laws. I mean, where is oppression not there? So there is rampant oppression all around, and the critic exaggerates the oppression in his expressions so as to amplify the degree of oppression that is there under the sun. What does he say? He says it is better to be dead. It's better to be dead than to live and be oppressed. Then he says that it is actually better for those who are unborn they are still better because they have neither seen nor endured it. He says that even those who are not born are in a better place than those who live and those who have died, those who haven't yet seen any evil. But you should understand that dead are better or unborn still are better. These are all expressions of language, just to let us know the kind of oppression that is there on the earth. One question I want to ask is, he says dead are better. Are the dead really better off? No, they are not better off if they have not known God. Because if they do not know God, if they have not formed a relationship with God, after they die, they go to a worst place. But then critic is arguing from a humanist point of view, so we should not get confused. So he says dead are better, the unborn are still better. And then in the beginning of the chapter, he says that, you know, there is nobody to comfort the oppressed. He talks twice about the oppressed people having no comforter. So that was the degree of oppression. Also, he mentions about tears. Behold the tears of the oppressed. When do people cry? Well, I'm not talking about people who cry at the fall of a hat. But to, for example, for a man to cry, or for a strong person to cry, something that really is unbearable for them should come in their way. Something that they are not able to bear emotionally or psychologically or mentally or physically. That's when they break and that's when tears come. So the critic's observation is that there is widespread oppression in this world. So with that kind of oppression, it is very difficult to enjoy the task you are doing. So that's why he says that even to enjoy the tasks or the labor that you do is a gift of God. The critic says that oppression is not good at all. It is wicked, and such people will be judged. My question to you all is, do you oppress anyone? Do you deal unkindly or unjustly with those over whom you yield power? It could be your spouse, it could be your children, it could be employees, it could be subordinates, it could be people who are not as smart as you. So that is one question. Second question, are you oppressed? If you are not the oppressor, are you the one who is oppressed? It's a challenge to rejoice in your work when you are oppressed at work. It is a challenge to rejoice in whatever labor you do if there is oppression. But the another side of that story is, if you accept it as something that is expected, then the oppression is more bearable. But anyway, I would rather ask you to trust on God and His gifts to rejoice in the tasks that He gives you. Let me go ahead. Let's get into what the critic or Solomon is going to consider in this chapter. After considering wisdom, riches, and tasks, the critic now throws up another interesting subject for consideration, and that is success, achievement, accomplishment. After throwing up a scenario where tasks may not be enjoyed, it takes us to the other end where tasks have not just been enjoyed, but they have led to success, accomplishments, and achievements. So from one opposite, he is now taking to the other end of the spectrum. Oppression was where tasks are not enjoyed, but success is where tasks are really enjoyed and people make good use of their opportunities. Now, who doesn't want success? Everybody wants success. And what determines success? It is the reward we get, the money we make, the fanfare that happens, the accolades that come along, the fame that it brings, and the fans, and the followers, and the worshippers that it creates. Success is in great demand. Now remember, the critic is considering it for meaning of life or fulfillment. So let us look at it. When we read verses 4 to 6, he brings up the first argument. Though success is a credible thing, he takes up the post-accomplishment scenario to evaluate whether it is worth it. So in verses 4 to 6, he says that when a man toils and does skillful work, it brings him success. But once he is successful, he ends up becoming a subject of envy. A subject of envy to those who are around him. Your success and accomplishment will naturally result in envy around you, in someone or the other. So what? What should we do now? Just because people around us will have envy, should we not work? Actually, sometimes this envy can take dangerous turns. It could lead to fight. It could lead to extortion. It could lead to betrayal, kidnapping, blackmailing, and even murder in the worst of scenarios. So should we not aim for success just because it's going to end up in envy? Should we just sit back? Well, the critic is quick to rebuke every thought of folding hands and sitting back without doing anything just because other people will envy. He says it is like eating one's own flesh. So sitting back without doing anything is not an option at all. But he says it is good to have enough on one hand, in one hand, a handful, than to try to grab as much as you can with both your hands and in the process get noticed by others. Okay, let me come again. A person who aims for just what's needed will be able to lead a quiet life. What he just needs, just enough. If he is just focused on that, he will lead a quiet life. He will not be noticed. He will not be envied. He will not see any fanfare, nor will he have a fan club. But if you are going to do extra work and make sure that both your hands are full, that means you're going to go extra mile for accomplishments, then people will notice and the quietness will go. The hard work that you will do to be successful will add noise into your life. So remember, now we are considering success. And in that, one of the flip sides of success is already been talked about, and that is the envy that success attracts. We will look at the second flip side. When we read verses 7 and 8, we'll see this. Success takes you to the top, but it is said that it is very lonely at the top. Successful people usually tend to be very lonely. Now, there are several reasons for this loneliness. Number one is that they could not invest enough time. Relationships mean time. Time needs to be invested. And usually successful people don't have that luxury of time. In the journey of success, they are so engaged in whatever they are up to that they are not able to give enough time. Serious relationships need time. But success demands time itself. Success comes at a cost. And time is the cost usually that they have to pay in bulk. Time is definitely something that rarely is handy for successful people. So one of the reasons they could be lonely is because they have no time to invest in relationships. Second reason why they can be lonely is because successful people tend to become self-centered. People who want to be successful have to be very conscious about themselves, very conscious about their time, their looks, their image, their routines, their habits, their environments, their eating, their choices. They can seem to be very snobbish because of the self-centeredness that usually is reflected by successful people. People don't stick around them. So that's another reason they could be lonely. The third thing is, successful people have trust issues. They lack trusting people. Successful people are skeptical about those around them. They can't easily trust. And usually they will not have the time, nor will they have the willingness to go into nitty-gritties of life. So you will see that usually they will either employ a professional or somebody very close to them whom they can trust blindly, like a mother or a father or a brother. Usually they will always fall back on that one person who can do most, who can take most of their decisions. And there's another reason that they are lonely. The fourth reason why successful people are lonely is because of disconnected relationships. What I mean by that is, the critic here says in verse number 8 that there is one alone without companion. He has neither son nor brother. He has neither son nor brother. Now, it is not that successful people do not have son or brother. They have. But they are disconnected to these people. Successful people usually are disconnected from very close people because they don't have time, because they're self-centered, they have trust issues. So they have disconnected relationships. And because of the above and more reasons, successful people are usually lonely. They have lots of acquaintances, but hardly any friends. There would be many who want to be around them and be called their friend, but there hardly might be anyone whom the successful people would want to call his friend. Now, successful people are lonely, and even if they want, they usually cannot do anything much about removing their loneliness because there is no end to his labors. Chapter 4 verse 8 says that there is no end to all his labors, nor is his eye satisfied with riches. Why doesn't he stop working hard? Why does a successful person why is he not able to sit quietly? Number one, because he has to maintain his lifestyle. To maintain the same level of lifestyle and the standard of life that he reaches after becoming successful, he will have to keep earning as hard as he has always done to reach there. And if he stops working hard, money will stop coming and he will not be able to maintain his lifestyle. Number two, why he cannot rest from his labors is because he has to remain marketable. To maintain the sheen of his accomplishments, he has to work his gut out because someone else is always trying to displace him. There is a lot of competition for success. So to remain marketable, he's always working hard on himself and on his projects and wherever he is involved. The third reason why he is not able to get a rest from his labors is because the money in his hand rapidly depletes. Now, this is a problem with money. Once you get them, they feel much less to be able to do anything with. When you're thinking that, okay, if I get 50 lakhs, it looks like a big sum. But once 50 lakh reaches your hands, then you don't know what to do with it. You feel that, arre, isse kya hoga? It is so less. And another thing is, they tend to empty up fast. That means when money comes, along with it comes a lot of expenses which we never expected. I mean, money brings with it, attracts, honeybees to the flower or moth to the light. lot of borrowers or lenders or suppliers and all kinds of people and expenses will turn up from God knows where. The fourth reason why he is not able to rest from his labors is endless ambition. After reaching a certain level, he suddenly sees there is something more that he doesn't have and others have. That makes him more ambitious, which means what brought him there will not take him ahead. So he will have to push in more labor. So if he worked 15 hours a day to reach there, now he'll have to work 18 hours to go to the next level. So he then pushes to go further up, and that is not easy. Why he is not able to rest from his labors is also because money means deployment. It demands deployment. They need to be deployed well because they can vanish quickly. So a lot of rich people are not able to sleep well just to make sure that their money is employed at the right place, and wherever it is parked, it is safe and it is doing well. It is performing well. So there is no end to his labors. So he first of all lonely, and then there is no end to his labors. He cannot stop because he is always working. He cannot stop to even think, okay, whom am I toiling for? I am sacrificing the good that I can get today for whom? If the answer is that is for my tomorrow and for my retirement years, that is a tomorrow that might never happen. So success blinds him, takes him on a journey at full speed, not allowing him to stop, not allowing him to think. So far we looked at the flip side of success. We saw one of the first points there is envy. Second point, the second flip side of success is loneliness. And that lonely person ends up into a cycle from which he is not able to come out, because he has to really work hard to remain successful. Now at this point, verses 9 to 12 of chapter number 4, the critic goes into a tangent and he is trying to discuss the value of friendship and companionship. When he thought about the loneliness of a successful man, he thought it wise to bring up the need for friendship and companionship. He cites things that stress that it is foolish to be alone. The critic starts off by saying that two are better than one, because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, one will lift up his companion. But woe to him who is alone when he falls, for he has no one to help him up. Again, if two lie down, they will keep warm. But how can one be warm alone? And though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him. So he says that two are better than one because two can be productive. They get a better reward since they can achieve more. Two can be helpful. They can help each other. When one falls, the other can lift. The two will be having comfort. They can make life more bearable. Warmth talks about comfort. The comfort that we have in the company of another person can make life more bearable. And last but not the least, he says that when two are there, there can be more safety and security. They can do a better resistance of the opposition and a better endurance to the temptation. But what is interesting is in verse number 12, he ends up with the mention of the threefold cord. He says that a threefold cord is not quickly broken. If you are thinking from a family perspective, children could be seen as a third cord. And they really do make breaking off of marriages very difficult. However, the critic is interpreting it as a reference to God. as a third God, and that looks more probable. Because at this point of time, I think it's not the critic, it's the author, Solomon, who comes in and says that God wants to be a part of our relationships. God wants to be a part of our friendship. And this is a lesson we should not forget. That verse of threefold cord is not quickly broken. It's not just for marriages. It is true for any relationship. Now let me come to the last part of chapter number 4. And that is verses 13 to 16. So the first thing we considered is that a successful person usually becomes an object of envy. A successful person also becomes lonely. Again, I repeat, success is what? Success is not getting success in what you are doing. But if you finish a task, that is success. No, we are not talking about that success of finishing a task. Success means reaching a place where you have more than what you need. A place of abundance. There is a great reward. There is a lot of fanfare. There is publicity. There are accolades. People are calling you for interviews. People want your autograph. People want to interview you. People want to stay around you, stick around you. There is a fame that comes along with the success. There is fans and followers that it creates. We're talking about that success. The third flip side of that kind of success is that this success is very fickle. F-I-C-K-L-E, fickle. To explain that, the critic talks about two people. If you read from verses 13 to 16, you will see these two people emerging. Who is the first guy? The first guy is a king who is wealthy and he is old. He is wealthy and he is old and he is a king. So he is successful because he is a person of power and authority. He has got fame, he has got wealth. But he is also old, which means he has seen success perhaps for a long time, or he took a long time to become successful. Whatever be the reason that he is old. But what is worth noticing there is that when the critic talks about this first guy, he says that this successful guy, the old and foolish king, he will be admonished no more. That means he doesn't want anybody's advices. There was a time when he welcomed admonishment. He welcomed people advising him. But now there is a time that has come where he is not willing to listen to anyone else. So success has got into his head and he is no longer willing to listen. So one of the things that success does is it gets into your head and you start behaving as if you know everything. You've seen, you've been there, done that kind of a thing. You know, when people come to you, there is a look on that face of yours where you are actually in that look, looking down on the person who is even trying to give you a small piece of advice. So this is the first guy. But then he brings up a second guy. He says, this guy was in prison. He was a poor guy. He was born poor. But then he comes up from that stage of poverty to prison. Now, prison doesn't mean that he was a thief. Prison could be that he was implicated. Maybe he was a small union leader and then he was put into prison because he was seen as a threat. So there is this guy who was born in a poor condition, goes through prison and then becomes the king. So he has a perfect story that's fit for a movie. He's a rags to riches person. In fact, he's a rags to prison to riches person. The critic says that this fellow got more following than the king before him. This fellow has now greater success than the king who must have put him in prison, or the king in whose place the old Polish guy, in his place this young fellow came up, and now he has greater fan following. Now I want to stop there and ask you a question. Have you thought about that first guy, the guy who got replaced? See, in the case of a king, it would have meant his life, because the next king comes, the first king has to die. He will not retire and live in some house like our president does. But in the case of normal people, think about the first guy. Suppose you are in a very credible position and somebody else comes to replace you. It could be a realization of a very painful transition. People are not ready to give up their places, not trade their places, because for them, that place of success is relevance. It is what gives them relevance. It is what gives them meaning. It is what fulfills them. So they are not able to move out of that place. It's very difficult to move on. And those people usually end up doing politics and all kinds of things. But interestingly, the critic brings out a third guy, a surprising guy, who is very subtly mentioned there. The critic ends by saying that even this guy, the second guy who had a rag to prison to riches today, he will be replaced by someone else who will come after him. And that guy may outperform him with a greater story. So what's the crux? It says that success is so fickle, it is not loyal to anyone. It will ultimately slip away and you will not be able to do anything about it. People will come after you and take that success which was dancing in your lap, and that success will now start dancing in their lap. It is vanity. So then let me come to the conclusion of chapter number 4. Success, just like wisdom, just like riches and tasks that were before it, is vanity too. This vanity, because it raises envy in people around us, not simple envy. Envy that can be very dangerous, where people can resort to violence and illegal steps to take care of that envy, to satisfy that envy. Success is vanity because it makes us lonely and puts in our hand something that will ultimately go away from us. And when it goes from us, if success is what has defined us, if success is what has given us meaning and fulfillment, it will be a total destruction of our lives. Then we will see success dancing in the life of someone else who comes to take our place. So don't chase success. It is one thing to be successful at what you are doing, to finish a task. But what I am talking about here is a success where you will want to remain. A success that brings a lot of adoration, admiration and fan following. A success which has the taste of fame and popularity in it. All this is vanity, a grasping for the wind. May God bless you.